Welcome all to my latest video, this one talking about the series on NBC, This Is Us. The specific episode that I am talking about today is from Season 4, Episode 5, titled Storybook Love. This Is Us is a series I have long intended to do a video about. My friend Stacy has wanted me to do something on this series for quite a few years now. She told me it was a series that made her cry every episode. Initially, I was confused why I would want to watch a series that would make me cry. She requested that I take a look at the first episode and see what I think then. Knowing the types of videos I have done up to that point, she thought the series would be right up my alley. To make a long story short, eventually, I did indeed sit down to watch the first ever episode of This Is Us. But I did not quite obey her, as I then went on to watch every episode that I could get my hands on, which at this point I think was deep into the first season. I was hooked. You might be asking at this point, did I cry after every episode? Well, let's just say my eyes may have misted every now and again. You know, a manly sort of misting. I've considered doing different videos about this series, and this is the one I'm finally doing. I'm not exactly totally ruling out that I might still do some of the videos that I had in mind before. In fact, this will probably not be the last time that I tackle this series. What form these future videos will take is yet to be determined. So before I go any further, I think it's important to provide a little background on the series, so that we can understand what we're talking about here. The series follows multiple timelines, one which shows the past of the adult characters, known as the Big Three, and a present-day timeline which shows their adult struggles with their lives, still suffering in a lot of ways from grief from the death of their father, which occurred in their teens. As the show has progressed, it has showcased different eras in the lives of the protagonists, including a future timeline, which so far we have gotten minimal details on. The show follows the lives of the three main characters, whom I've already referenced as the Big Three. There's Kate, who has weight issues, for starters, played by Chrissy Metz. I was actually not familiar with this actress. I don't think I've ever seen her in anything else other than this series. There's her brother, Kevin, who is a celebrity in his own right. He was a star of a fictional show within the show's universe called The Manny. He's played by a guy that I knew from Smallville in Justin Hartley. And finally, there's Randall. He was a black child abandoned at the hospital who the Pearson family adopted after one of the three kids they were having unfortunately died at childbirth. One of the things that has impressed me with the series is the fact that they don't gloss over some of the issues that would arise in a situation like that. The racial issues are not overlooked in the series and have in fact been significant in the past couple of episodes. They could have easily just ignored the issue, and it impresses me that they didn't. Randall, for the record, is played by Sterling K. Shepard, who has won a well-deserved Emmy for his role. In the earlier timelines, the characters are played by younger actors, and the casting for these younger actors is uncanny. Like, they do an exceptional job of playing the younger versions of the adult characters. Especially any of the actors that have so far played Kate. Like, the teenager version one has gotten, like, Chrissy Metz's mannerisms down pat. It really is an impressive job. Playing the Big Three's parents is Milo Ventimiglia. I actually had to go on YouTube to find a pronunciation because I had never actually heard it pronounced. And I think I did a pretty decent job figuring that out. But anyway, some of you would probably know him from the show Heroes. I actually more remember him as playing Rocky's son in Rocky Balboa. Amusingly enough, Sylvester Stallone has guest starred on the series. Playing Rebecca, the mother, is Mandy Moore, who is absolutely fantastic. I've seen her do a lot of things, and this is probably the most impressive that I've ever seen her. Especially playing the older version of the character. The show does an excellent job of dealing with mental health issues, ranging from anxiety, weight issues, to alcoholism and addiction. In my opinion, the show looks at these issues honestly and with insight. The fact that the show has tackled these issues is the main reason that my friend Stacy wanted me to take a look at the series in the first place. As I said, the episode that I'm talking about today is the 5th episode of the 4th season. The episode's description reads as follows. Rebecca hosts a dinner party. Kevin tries to support those around him. Randall faces concerns about how his family is adjusting to a new home. It's not exactly the greatest description in the world, but the episode has multiple storylines. I will be focusing on one of them, the one involving Randall. Randall, for a time, was actually my favorite character of the series. That slowly moved over to Justin Hartley's character in Kevin. In this episode, his daughter has a panic attack at school. This forces Randall, a newly minted councilman, to leave a meeting with a fellow councilman named Wilkins. Wilkins doesn't appear to be too sympathetic, and later in the episode, Randall gets a text saying that his colleague is angry. Worry not. Randall smooths things over by pretending to suck at golf in the next episode, but that is a story for a future video. Maybe. Randall throughout the series has long been known to suffer from anxiety as well as panic attacks. He's had more than a few breakdowns throughout the series, both in the past and the present timelines. The fact that his daughter is now suffering from panic attacks confirms for him one of his worst fears. That he would pass down his anxiety attacks to his children. This is actually one of my fears, too. That I would pass my own problems down to my daughter, either because it's genetic, or because she would learn the patterns that lead to them from me. I related to Randall in this situation far more than I have in this episode than I have in a while. Initially, Randall tries to use his experience to comfort his daughter. It doesn't work. She isn't thrilled to have this in common with her father, and who really could blame her? Even going so far as to say that she doesn't want to be anything like him, which, ouch. That's the type of hurtful thing that teenagers are very good at coming out with. Beth has a flashback to a conversation with Randall's biological father, William, who Randall actually meets in the premiere episode of the series. The timeline is season 1. I believe when Randall has a mental breakdown. William reveals to Beth that he too suffered from similar issues for his entire life, though back when he was a kid, they didn't have a name for it. Nor I'm sure an effective treatment. Like Randall, William laments that he possibly could have passed that down to his son. The unfortunate fact of the matter is that you don't get to pick and choose what your children inherit from you. Good or bad. William in this scene tells Beth a trick that used to work for him. As a result of this memory, Beth calls for a meeting between father and daughter and gives a speech, something that is generally Randall's domain, but in this episode, Beth is the one doing it. She tells them that she won't have Randall or Tess talking badly about her 3 favorite people in the world. It should be noted that there actually is another daughter, Annie, and an adopted daughter, Deja. If I'm being a smart aleck, I'm taking her comments to mean that they are not included among her 3 favorite people. I don't think that's quite what she was getting at, so I digress. She shares with them the trick that William shared with her. She pours a glass of seltzer, and she instructs them to remember that the bubbles will always settle, just like their anxious thoughts will always eventually calm down. I can sort of see where this would be effective. The bubbles in the seltzer water could give them something to concentrate on to calm their thoughts. Will this actually work for them? I'm not really sure, but it's definitely something worth trying. In my experience, you need multiple strategies for dealing when your anxiety is high, especially if you're not using medication. The fact of the matter is that you will rely on specific strategies. Your main one will sometimes fail you, so you need to have backup strategies for dealing with it. That night, Beth tells Randall that she found a therapist for Tess, as well as one for Randall. Randall is fine, of course, with Tess getting help, but he's a little annoyed that she is also suggesting it for him. He denies the need for help, but she points out that there are signs that he's headed for another breakdown. He insists that he's fine, in a way that didn't convince me any. I doubt it did anything for her. But since he completely shuts down any more communication on this issue, there really isn't that much that she can do, unfortunately. We are likely headed for another Randall breakdown storyline, though none of the episodes that have aired after this have suggested it. Still, this scene doesn't bode well. At any rate, I think that about does it for this video. I don't think I have anything else to say at the moment. If you like this video, please subscribe to my channel, share the video, and like it. My daughter continuously yells at me for not saying exactly that, so the fact that I'm saying it now, I hope makes her proud. Anyway, this is Dave Corman signing off.